So today we are going to discuss something about theoretical framework as well as therapeutic models. So when we deal with this topic, it is a very vast topic, and we are going to discuss about a few theories. And actually, we'll have to spend a lot of time to actually understand all the theories in detail. So I'm just this presentation is going to be just like a tip of the iceberg. We are just going to have an overall idea about what is it all about. And in the presentation, I will try to make a difference between what do you mean by theoretical framework as well as therapeutic model, or how they are interconnected, and how it will be useful in our clinical practices. Okay, so this is the aim of the class. If you have any doubt or clarification, you can note it down, and at the end of the class, we'll have some time to clarify and discuss over it. So just to, 1 minute, yeah. Just to begin with, anyway, we are going to discuss about theory and social work. So when we say psychiatric social work, psychiatry is one of the field of social work. And specifically we gave a name for that is called psychiatric social work, because the field is very unique and specific. So we call it as psychiatric social work, but basically we are all social workers. So before talking about the theories, we should understand how we reach into these kind of theories, where we started utilizing all these theories. As a social worker, as a trainee, we all know that how social work has evolved. We know that we all started from a charity and humanity, where there were a lot of social issues which need to be addressed, like because of the urbanization, industrialization. There were so many problems like poverty, unemployment, related issues. So somebody has to address that. Then there people started addressing those things, that is called charity. So then charity organization, so charity became a little more organized, and charity organizers, society started appointing friendly visitors, settlement houses formed. So gradually the charity started having a form or an organized way. So this was the beginning of social work. So always the roots of our professions are rooted in actually humanity and charity. So from there we begin. Gradually we evolved into an occupation and to a profession, where we started looking into other fields, and we started taking up family, child welfare, mental health. Post then the First and Second World War happened, then there were a lot of issues with related to that. We all and social workers started looking into that. Gradually we evolved into a profession where we were a paid profession evolved, and gradually it became a profession. All in this process, even though we started with charity and helping profession, over a period of time, when it evolved as an occupation, as a profession, importance of theory came in. So till then, it was a charity work, prioritizing needs and fulfilling needs. But gradually, the need for theoretical understanding and interpretation of the problem in a theoretical perspective started coming as a need. From there, we started looking for adequate and appropriate theories, and we gradually adopted few theories from other profession, and we started looking at developing our own theories also. So this is the background of the theoretical understanding or the utilization of theory into our profession had happened. So as I told, so our basic principle remained in those kind of humanity and charity, but gradually and always we understand the problem in the social context of human being. But gradually the need for theory came into because of various reasons. So we started looking for theories. So today we are going to look into a few theories which we frequently utilize in our clinical practices and which are comparatively popular and famous among the social workers. So I'll be touching upon few of the major theories. Briefly, I'll discuss. Okay. To begin with, we can begin with the psychodynamic theories or psychodynamic approach. So that was one of the prominent and initial theory that started interpreting mental health issues and social work, the professional social work also started understanding, adopting this theoretical perspective into our field. So very, very briefly, to understand what do you mean by psychodynamic theories, it was proposed by, we know that Sigmund Freud. So they talk about different things, ego, superego, unconscious, subconscious, and conscious mind, then psychosexual stages of development, and they talk about defense mechanism. These are the basic concepts they talk about in this theory. What are they? What is the relevance? I will try to talk about that. So when you look at the structure of personality, so they talk about id, ego, and superego. What are they? So according to this theory, so id, part of our personality is where all the primitive biological part of the mind, where all our impulses, needs, urges are situated. You just to understand, it's called id part of personality. On the other hand, superego means like, no, I will come to ego. Before that, I'll talk about superego, which has all the moral part of the personality, where all the rules and regulations which we learn through our socialization process or observation or from the family, we learn a lot of morality, right? So that is superego. So when I say ego and superego, there is a possibility of a conflict between id and superego. Why? So take it as an example, it is like a child. So look at the child. What is the speciality of a child? Child doesn't know what is right and wrong, right? For an example, if you take a child to a supermarket or a shop, child will start looking at things, and child will start get attracted to many things, and child will start demanding, I want this and I want this. Child doesn't know that it is a shop. A child doesn't know that, no, we need to spend money for that, and we can get it only if we pay. And we are generally supposed to buy when it is needed. So child doesn't have such kind of rules and regulation, but only feel like I has a urge or need to get those things. So our id are like that. So on the other hand, superego are like our maybe parents or our grandparents who teach us a lot of rules and regulation. Don't do that. Don't do this. So that is superego part. So always child, this ego and superego will have a conflict. So those conflicts are called, and this conflict cannot be continuously gone, right? So these conflicts are not very good. Then the ego comes. So that is the ego, the reality principle of ego. Then ego comes and try to resolve this conflict. Somehow we want to resolve this conflict between id and superego, right? Because ongoing conflicts are not good. So ego somehow resolve this conflict utilizing defense mechanism. So I'm just very, very, very simplifying this theory to understand in a practical way. So to resolve this conflict, ego use different type of healthy as well as unhealthy coping mechanism. So there are different types of defense mechanism, but generally ego use it for resolving the conflict that arises between ego and superego. So suppression, regression, there are many things, sublimation. We no need to go into detail of that, but ego utilizes this kind of defense mechanism to resolve conflicts between these two, id and superego. In that process of resolving the conflict through defense mechanism, either the so-called unconscious mind will be formed. So through suppression, regression, and all many of the feelings like, you know, urges and needs will be suppressed or controlled, and those will be put into put into unconscious mind. So when we pass through different lives, like the psychosexual stages of development, I initially told, no, when you pass through, this conflict will happen through this kind of mechanism. This will be put into unconscious mind to resolve this conflict. Gradually, the unconscious mind will become larger. And one problem with unconscious mind is like, no, it everything will be put into the unconscious mind, but one issue is like, no, the conscious mind or that person will not have any direct access to the unconscious mind. That person doesn't know what is actually there in the unconscious mind, but unconscious mind will have access to this person. That unconscious mind can influence the psychological the functionality of the person's psychology of that person, feelings and emotions of the person. So it will badly affect the person indirectly, even though that person doesn't have a direct access to unconscious mind. Unconscious mind can influence this person. Those influence will be resulted as a disorder, maybe anxiety, stress, depression, schizophrenia, everything. For everything, they have an explanation for that. But this is the underlying mechanism. So this theory talk about this. This is, in this process, unconscious mind will be formed, and this unconscious kind will cause dysfunction in that person through influencing this many ways. Okay, so this is one theory is talking about how problem arises and maintained. So this theory will give a theoretical understanding about problem. This is a one theoretical approach. So what is the intervention strategy they put forward? So the only solution is, like, if that person get to know about what is there in the unconscious mind and get an insight about, or come to know what is there in the unconscious mind, that knowing itself will resolve many of the problem. Okay, so they use different strategies: analysis of dream, analysis of resistance, analysis of transference, free association. These are some of the intervention strategies through which the therapist help the person to get to know about what is there in the unconscious mind. So once that person develop insight in that process, the problem can be resolved. This is one theory. Okay, very complicated or very little complex theories, but just for your understanding, I'm just talking about, because this was one of the prominent theory. So this is one of the theories that we utilize in our clinical practice. This is a theoretical framework, okay, one thing. But I will talk about what is therapeutic models later. Next common theories that we utilize in our clinical practice are called behavioral theories. This is entirely different from what we already did. So now that is one theory that we generally utilize in our clinical practice. Another theory that very commonly utilized are called behavioral theories or behavioral approach. Under behavioral approach or theories, there are three types of, there are three theories, that is Pavlov's classical conditioning, Skinner's operant principles, and Bandura's social modeling theories. So these are all behavior theories. Basically, what behavior theories are telling, behaviors are the result of interaction between the environment and individual and the environment. To simplify it, like, you know, all our behaviors are learned in the process of interaction with our environment. All our behaviors we learn. Since we learn all behavior, according to behavior theories, we can unlearn as well as relearn also. This is the basic principles of behavior theories. What does it mean? Okay, now we'll come to psychiatry, mental health, I will talk about. So when they say all the behaviors, so according to them, all the disorders are all behavior, depression, anxiety, everything is a behavior. So in depression, what happened? This person is not interacting, not talking, not having initiative. So it's a behavior changes you observe, right? So everything according to them is a behavior. And why those kind of disorder kind of behavior is occurring? Because you learn it in a particular way. That is why it is happening. Such kind of behaviors are happening because you learned in that way. So what they suggest, but that's okay. Even though you learn in that way, you can unlearn and relearn also. So those theories will tell us, the conditioning theories, operant theories, and modeling theory will tell us how you learn a behavior. So if you know how you learn a behavior, same principle that you can follow to learn new behavior or unlearn is already learned behavior and all. That is all about behavior theories. I'll try to explain those three theories. So conditioning, no? So you all know about this experiment. So don't confuse about unconditional stimulus, conditioned response and all. Don't worry. What was the experiment? From this, only this theory easily can be understood. So generally, you know that we all have some pets at home or dogs. So generally, it is a general thing that we observe, like when we give some food to the dog, no, the dog will just start salivating. That is, we know that that is a normal response. So salivating to a food is a normal response. Okay. So the scientist observed that. Then he thought of doing another experiment with that. So along with serving food, whenever we introduce food to the dog, they started doing another thing also. They started ringing a bell along with introducing food, and they continuously started doing it. over a period of time, they observed that just ringing bell started producing the effect that is called salivating. So initially, dog was salivating only to the food. Later, when they started doing food and bell together, after a point of time, the bell was able to produce salivation at dog. Means what? The bell is acquired the response of the food. Actually, food was actually producing salivation over a period of time when both of them introduced together. The bell acquired the response of the food. Which one is that? Salivation. So this is called conditioning. What does it mean? When two things happen together, one can acquire the response of the other. Simple principle. When two things happen together, one can acquire the response of the other. That is called conditioning. Okay. So how this is? This is called conditioning theory. So how it is useful? For an example, this theory can be utilized for understanding many of the. This is one way of learning, right? So they learn. For an example, a person has fear, a phobia of closed space, or fear of a lift. You know what is lift, right? There are many people come and meet you, telling that they are very scared about lift. They cannot get into lift. They feel very uneasy. They feel suffocated. They feel they may not. They cannot escape. Something will happen to them. But a lift is not that dangerous, right? Why a person is behaving that way when they see a lift or get into a lift? Just maybe a conditioning. For an example, something might have happened when that person was in some of the lift. Okay, he was, something might have witnessed or see or experienced. So some danger feeling that person might have happened. So then that person might have developed a lot of anxiety symptom, because if you actually meet a danger, you are natural to have a anxiety or fearful responses, physiological arousal, something of that sort. Okay, so lift was there, danger was there. So today, danger response also happened, right? So, but gradually, what happened? The lift acquired the response of the danger. So then, when later the lift is able to produce such kind of responses, so the conditioning happened. So these kind of conditioning principles will help us to interpret many of the disease conditions. For an example, you are crossing the road, suddenly a bus came to hit you, something of that sort. You got very scared, right? So there was a chance of accident, bus, and response of the accident of anxiety. Since accident and bus came together, the bus acquired the response of the accident. Later, the bus without accident will produce anxiety symptoms. So that is how you become very panicked to bus. For an example, I'm giving simple example. So this is how conditioning principle will help you to understand a problem. Then it comes to operant conditioning. So another experiment where it's a very well-known experiment where they put a rat into a cage, and there are many switches. If a cat press one knob, food will come. If cat press another switch, the cat will get a shock in the cage. So this was simply, I am keeping it to the minimum so that you can understand the experiment. So later they observed something like the cat started pressing only one button, which give food, and rat did not stop touching the knob which give shocks. But how does it happen? Again, learning. So according to operant conditioning theory, we learn behavior based on the consequence of our behavior. The rat pressed one knob, then rat started getting food, which is nice thing, rewarding thing. That is called rewarding. Something which you like or good thing, that is rewarding. And when rat was pressing something else, the rat started getting shock, which is not very pleasant, no? So the consequence of pressing one knob was shock, another one was food. So the consequence, one was good, another was bad. Then the rat stopped pressing one thing and start pressing other things. So the rat learned the behavior of pressing which one and not to press which one based on the consequence of the behavior of pressing. So this is called conditioning principle. So we learn many things based on the consequence of our behavior. For an example, if you do something, people appreciate, right? So the appreciation is something good. So when you get something good, that is why people appreciate you. So then you tend to do it again. So when if somebody punishes, then you stop. No, same principle. So I'll just rephrase one more time. So what are the consequences? So we learn behaviors based on the consequences. So there are two types of consequences. The one is reinforcement, and the one is punishment. If the consequence of the behavior is something reinforcing, we tend to repeat that behavior. So when you repeat it, that we learn it and we'll do it again and again, that will become a behavior or a character. Punishes, on the other side, that will is again a consequence or a response of our behavior that will reduce the likelihood of happening bad behavior. So this is a principle through which we can understand many of our behaviors, and we can change many of the behavior. Behaviors means disorder per se. Last one is modeling. Modeling means like, you know, we learn many things through observing. Okay, it's a very simple example. Like you look at observe. Children show many behavior through modeling, observing their parents or observing something in the TV. So they observe, model it, and inculcate in their behavior. So this is what very, very to minimal level, what you mean by behavioral theories, which is very different from psychodynamic theory, which we talked about. Now we will come to another theory, is called cognitive theory. So in psychodynamic approach, we were giving more importance to unconscious mind. In behavioral theories, we were giving a lot of importance to learning, how we learn and behavior. Cognitive theory is a little different from all those things, and they give importance to something different. So what is cognitive theory? Basic presumption or assumption of cognitive theory. It is not event per se which determine our feelings, but the meaning that we attach to these events. What does it mean? So there are so many things that is happening in and around us, right? So many good thing, bad thing, we don't know. A lot of things will happen. So according to these theories, the event itself is not going to create good feeling or bad feeling inside you. Okay, but sometimes you can feel sad. Sometimes you can be happy. Sometimes you can be angry. Sometimes you can be anxious, worried. For an example, you are asked to go and meet your HOD. So you are going and meeting the HOD. You feel very anxious, right? So according to this theory, it is not going and meeting the HOD is creating the anxiety, but the meaning that you give to that going and meeting HOD is creating responses. So what do you feel? What do you think inside when you go and meet HOD? You are going to HOD's room, then you start interpreting, oh, I'm going to HOD. What will happen? Why does HOD called me? Whether HOD is going to scold me or something wrong happened with me. If you start interpreting those events in that way, you feel a little anxious and nervous. See, the cognition is, if another person feel, okay, the HOD called me to appreciate something, then this person feel happy, right? So the way we interpret is going to define our emotions and behavior. Individuals are actively involved in constructing their reality. Construction means giving meaning, interpreting. A person chooses her own viewpoint. Same point I am putting in a different sentences for you people to understand in a better way. Information processing become distorted when we experience emotional distress. So what this theory is telling, like, you know, the people who develop problems, no, mental health problem, anxiety, depression, whatever it may be, they are feeling anxious and depressed because they misinterpret or give a different meaning to the events that is happening in and around. So they give different meaning, different types of meaning, which may not be very, very realistic or rational. So that will lead into emotional or behavioral problems. So this kind of misinterpretation will happen, or information processing become distorted when we experience emotional distress. When we are under distress, this kind of mistake can be quite common. So some of the mistakes, they have, like, you know, cognitive errors, I just put up for your understanding, all of that thing. These are some of the distorted way of thinking that can happen when we are under emotional distress. So those distortions may lead into emotional behavior problems. So I already told the interpretation, the meaning that we give to a situation is going to give the response, like emotional or behavior response. So this meaning or misinterpretation or distortion can happen in three levels. Okay. So it's thinking when we, so I told, no, in the interpretation or thinking. So the way we think and understand, there is the problem, the way we interpret. So when I said thinking, according to this theory, thinking can happen in three levels, and those distortions and or irrational or illogical thinking can happen in three levels. Okay, that so the levels can be core belief, underlying assumptions, and negative automatic thoughts. So don't get worried about what is it all about. So these are happening in three levels. So, and because of the distortion, we tend to develop emotional and behavioral problems. So what is core belief? Core beliefs are something like to understand in an easier way. It may not be an appropriate comparison, but it is something like, you know, we learn something unconscious mind, you know, something of that way. It is little underlying, little hidden, but it is accessible. This kind of core belief about self, others, and future, we develop through our early childhood experience. Through our experiences, we tend to create some kind of impression about ourselves, about others, and all. So that is happening through our experience, and that will be there. We may not be very well always knowing that. It will be underlying there in our mind. But if you try, we can access, but it's not always visible. We will not be knowing that I am holding this kind of core belief. So we will develop some kind of core belief that itself will be some way distorted, and that will lead into developing a lot of assumptions and rules in our life. So for an example, I say that, no, I developed my concept about me through my experience. I had a bad childhood experience. My father was very punitive. From schooling, I got a lot of punishment. And then I started getting a feeling like I am not a good person. Everybody is scolding me, which means I am a bad person. So if the, I believe that kind of core belief about me, I develop some rules like, no, so I should be very vigilant. I should be very careful. I should behave very consciously. Otherwise, I will do some mistakes. So I should do things perfectly. So such kind of rules I develop, that will lead into a lot of anxiety. So those rules will lead our behaviors. So when you go to actual situation, actual social situation, for an example, again, I'm making a speech in front of people. Then this underlying assumption, no, so you should be very careful. You should present perfectly. You should not make any mistake. Otherwise, you are a bad person. People will find out your mistake. Then you will get negative automatic thoughts in situation. People are looking at you. You may do some mistake. Such kind of thought will come in your mind. If you do mistake, people will laugh at you. Such kind of thought will come. Then you become very anxious, worried, and you. That is how you develop anxiety in front of other people, and you develop social anxiety. I'm just giving an example to understand how distorted thoughts can happen in three levels and how that will lead into problem. So again, cognitive approach, what they focus more on cognition, thinking, interpretation. And if our interpretations become illogical and irrational, we develop problems. Simple way of understanding. What is the time? So I will speed up. Humanistic theory that we generally utilize. So what humanistic theory is about? Humans are primarily driven by motivation to self-actualize, to achieve our full potential. People are constrained by their environment. Only be able to self-actualize if their environment supports them. So this is humanistic theory. What are they talking about? So simply to understand, I will make again an example for you people to understand. What do you mean by humanistic theory? What are they trying to say? So humans are like a seed. Okay, you know seed, what do you mean by seed? Like each, maybe a tree or a plant has a seed, right? So what is the speciality of a seed? Seed is very small, but the seed has the potential to become or to actualize a big tree, right? So even though it's a very small seed, it has all the potentials and it can grow into a large big tree. But it cannot just simply grow just like that. It can grow only if a suitable or a conducive environment is provided to the seed. For an example, if you keep the seed in your almara or in your side of home, it will not grow, right? It will remain there and it will perish there itself. On the other hand, if you put the seed outside and you make a you dig and keep inside the your place and you water it and nurture it, it will and you get enough sunlight, it will gradually grow and become actualized and it become a big tree, right? So human beings are also like that according to this theory. We all have the potential to become what you actually wanted to become. Sometimes you may not be able to become what you actually wanted to become. So why? Because you do not have a conducive environment to become what you actually wanted to become. So then what happened there is a incongruency or difference between what you are right now or what you actually become. You actually wanted to become something, but you are not reaching. Then you have a lot of problem, right? So your problem will increase. So according to them, this incongruency is creating problem. Why this incongruency develops? Because maybe you are not having a conducive environment. So what they provide, then only they are. So this theory is talking about unconditional positive regards, empathy, warmth. What are those? This is a conducive environment. So warmth, empathy, positive regards are a very good, nice thing, right? So in the therapy, you provide this atmosphere that is a conducive environment. Then this person himself will be able to identify, understand what is the potential, what he actually wanted, what is struggle in between, what change I like. So incongruency will be kind of if I become unstable, if you just let me know, okay. Those conducive and provide that will help the person to actualize what is your potential. That is another, that is a very, very gist of humanistic theory. Biopsychosocial, everybody knows, like, I don't want to spend so much of time. According to one of the prominent approach in mental health, where biopsychosocial says no single illness, patient or condition can be reduced into any one aspects. All three levels, biological, psychological and social, must be taken into account in every health aspects. They are all more or less equally all illness at all times. According to this theory, what to the biological, social, and psychological factors in play and illness or disease creation. So biopsychosocial approach, as I told, no, it is something like a multifactorial causality where multiple factors come together and cause a problem. For an example, to understand, now we are all dealing with COVID, right? So take an example of COVID. Even though COVID is because of some infection that is happening, why it is spreading through? Because of the our behaviors, our social interaction, many things are coming together, right? So multiple factors coming together to cause a disease or health condition. So that is, and all these factors need to be considered and given equal importance when we deal with such kind of condition. That is called biopsychosocial model. Person in environment approach, that is one of the major approach which we follow, which was proposed by our Mary Richmond. What do you mean by person in environment approach? So individual and his or her multiple environment are dynamic interactive system in which each component simultaneously affects and affected by each other, which means a person is always in interaction and interdependent with the environment. We are always interacting with the environment. So we can develop problem if there is some problem in the interaction. So this concept is a two-way process where individual's well-being is we'll have to look at what is happening to the individual. At the same time, we'll have to look into the environment in which that person lives. So because sometimes individual fails to utilize the environment or fails to understand, interact and utilize the environment because of the personal difficulties, or sometimes the environment itself become very unjust, inadequate, a lot of inequality, injustice are going on, that is affecting that person. So we like to look into the individual's ability, the ability of the individual's family or group, as well as you look into the social factors and look for what is happening, so that changing in the individual's ability as well as bringing social reforms will resolve the problem. That is what you call person in environmental approach. So last one is strength perspective. Yeah, so in mental health. So till now we were talking about all problem. So through because of you are developing an unconscious mind, you are developing a problems and deal with that. So we focus on problem there. Behavior theory also, you learn a problem behavior. So again, we are focusing on the problem. cognitive theory again talking about distorted thinking, and you develop a problem. Again, we are looking at the problem. Biopsychosocial approach also looking at the problem. So strength perspective is a little different from that, which talks like, you know, what they focus not on the problem, rather focus on the strength and capacity of the person. So according to this theory, individuals and their families are having potentials as opposed to being at risk. Those individuals and their families have strength, resources, and the ability to recover from adversity, as opposed to emphasizing problem, vulnerabilities, and deficits. So according to this approach, rather than focusing on the problem and see what problem that person developed through, why did that person develop that problem, what is the deficiency that person is having, try to focus on what are the strength, opportunity, resources available for that person and utilize them. So through increasing your strength and capacities, that person can come out of the problem, come out of the situation. That is a simpler understanding of strength perspective. So in deficit model or problem model, we focus on negative experiences, and through negative experiences we have a low self-esteem and we develop a lot of negative behaviors, and we see what are the deficit happen because of that, and we label those kind of deficit as unconscious mind or irrational thoughts or something, and we prescribe interventions to resolve that, where we don't focus much on the opportunities, resources, and capacity that person has. So on the other hand, in strength-based approach, we identify the strength of the person, continue to help that person to develop the strength and capacities, and that through which a positive and a valued, meaningful experience that person will have, and that will lead into a positive development. So this is the similar understanding of strength perspective. So in theory, in therapies or our practice, we try to find out the strength of the person. So to you can follow a ROPS model, where we look for resources, options, possibilities, exceptions, and solutions. Okay, this is all strength approach. So I was talking purely about theories. So how theory means, theory will explain how something is happening, how a phenomenon is happening, it will explain. So I will very briefly talk about, I think I have maybe 5-10 minutes. What do you mean by therapeutic model? Whether both are same or both are entirely different, or both are interconnected. So according to me, the therapeutic models and theoretical framework are interconnected. Models are a visual and a verbal representation of theories or concepts. Models simplify a theory or concept for a better understanding. Models are based on theories or concepts to build upon. Models are based on one or more theories. Theories can be considered as an answer to various problems identified, especially in a scientific world, while models can be considered as a representation created in order to explain the theory. What does it mean? So theories will tell us things can happen in this way. So therapeutic models, what are therapeutic models? So we understand and utilize these theoretical explanation, theoretical framework, and in combination, alone or in combination of theories, we develop a framework to understand why this person developed a problem. So we make a pictorial representation utilizing the theoretical framework to understand the current problem of the person. And that will give a direction or a blueprint of action or intervention to do with this person. I will give examples, then it will be easy for you to understand. For an example, I talked about biopsychosocial theories, right? Psychosocial theories, where psychological, biological, social factors comes together, and a person, those factors will lead into a problem. So a therapeutic conceptualization utilizing biopsychosocial theory of somatization. So a person is having somatization. So the environmental factors like stress, other reinforces, culture may be contributing to that. The sick role behavior will be contributing to that. The genetic vulnerability of that person, and psychological factors like emotional deficit, cognitive, and then other psychopathology, all will be contributing, and that person is developing somatization. So we take that theory and develop a framework of like this, and So, and from the information which we collect from the patient, we put into a framework to understand what is happening with this person. That is called therapeutic models. Another example I can give you. Anger and edge. A child is very angry. So a child is showing anger behavior at home. So how it can be understood utilizing a therapeutic model. So we can, to understand the anger of the child, we can rely upon behavioral theories, and we can utilize the behavioral theories principle to make a model of what is happening in the child. It is just giving an example, okay? So child is showing anger. How child might have been developed? So child might have observed, so modeling, okay, might have observed parents who are quarreling at home for something. So child might have observed and modeled it, or child might have seen some kind of angry behavior in TV or cartoon or something, looked at and modeled and incorporated in the behavior. That can be one thing. So when child started showing angry, so when child started showing angry, parents might have started giving up. So child may be showing angry for something. Okay, then parents started giving it off to the child. So that giving it off, it may be reinforcing the anger. So whenever child shows anger, child gets something. So a pleasant thing, no, rewarding. So child, the anger is rewarded. So the anger behavior is maintained. So utilizing behavioral theories, we are making a framework to understand why this child is showing anger and why this anger behavior is maintained. So another example of therapeutic model utilizing behavior theory principles to understand anger of a child. So how we can utilize theories to develop therapeutic models. Okay, I'll skip this. So see, depression, to understand depression. So to understand depression in a person, we utilize cognitive theories as well as behavioral theories. We take the theoretical framework of cognitive theory as well as behavioral theories, and we make a framework. As I told in cognitive theory, through early childhood experience, and all, this person might have developed assumption about himself and others, and that is leading to automatic thoughts. When, because of automatic thoughts, this person started showing some kind of behavior and emotion. Behavior can be like, you know, avoiding, not going out, interacting with people. When that person avoid and not going outside with anxiety and fear and tension may be relieved. So relief of those anxiety symptom can be seen as a negative reinforcer, and that will maintain the behavior of avoidance. Don't worry about this model. Okay, I'm just telling you will be learning. See, I'm utilizing cognitive models as cognitive theories as well as behavior theory to make a therapeutic models. This model means I'm understanding what is happened to that person, and this framework will help me to do intervention for the person. Another example, I'm just giving different therapeutic models utilizing theory principles, so that now you will understand what is it and how it is interconnected and how it can be utilized. Again, I am utilizing cognitive theories as well as behavior theories to understand and interpret and make a framework of OCD in a person. Okay, so you will be learning about OCD, or you will be already knowing that. So OCD, obsession, compulsion. Obsessions are thought, compulsions are behavior. So obsession will be triggered by situations. So that are called triggering events. So a triggering event, and that triggering events will lead into some kind of obsessive thoughts inside you. Then you will start interpreting those kind of thoughts. Maybe you will start believing, or you will falsify, or you will increase in sense of responsibility, thought, acts, and fruition. So you will start giving meaning to that. Again, cognitive theory. When you give meaning to that, that will lead into some kind of behaviors. Okay, so, okay. For an example, I touch somewhere. I get a thought, your hand is dirty. Then I will believe, so actually I touched here. Actually, my hand is dirty. Then I'll go and wash my hand. I will repeatedly wash my hand because I believe my hand is actually dirty. Or washing will reduce my anxiety. Something I believe, I wash, then my tension will come down. So the reduction of tension work as a reinforcer. So our compulsion washing behavior will again continue. Again, I'm utilizing either misinterpreting, believing that my hand is dirty is cognitive theory. reduction of anxiety and reduction of that anxiety working as a negative reinforcer and maintain watching behavior, I am utilizing cognitive theory. So I am making a therapeutic model to understand how the OCD is maintaining this person and making a therapeutic model. And this will help me for intervention. Similarly, again, I am giving another example of social anxiety. Okay, I think you understood what it is now. So to conclude, are these theories sufficient enough to grasp the world as it is interpreted by the client? So I was talking about different theories, around 6-7 theories I told. So the question why I put across here is like, is it sufficient? So for an example, you understood all the theories, you understood what is the underlying principles and what actually they are trying to tell you. So you understood the theories and you become very well-versed in these theories. Is it sufficient to become a very good psychiatric social worker or a clinician? So the answer is no. From my experience or from my reading, I'm just telling, okay, there will be people with a difference of opinion. Why I told no, because the theories lead ones to expect that our work with human problems is subject to control, measurement, prediction, systematization, and expertise, promoting the illusion that plans, answers, and solutions exist. So telling them, oh, I know all the theories now. Okay, a person is telling a problem. I know that how that problem is evolved and maintained. Okay, I know. So don't believe that now all the problems of the human beings can be understood and interpreted in this small framework of these kind of theories. So when you actually talk to a person and when you try to understand his problem or his own world, you will realize that now the person experiences the person's problem and interpretation, the background of the person will be much larger. And you cannot just limit that person into these kind of theories. So just theoretical understanding itself will not make you an expert and make you to help the person. And then what else you need? Again, you'll have to, what I suggest is like, going back to our base route. So the kind of creative, imaginative, and reflective thought that are required to grasp the world as it is interpreted by the client is very important, can be shared from humanities, where humanities, understanding the person, understanding from his social, cultural, and economic background is very important. So from where we will get that, the unique ethos of our profession. You go back to our profession, our professional, the beginning of the starting of the profession and the ethics and our understanding of the profession itself is very great. That will help you. The inclusive way we understand the problem of the client involving family, community, and society, that also will help you. Not only the theories and knowledge, but that which we learn from the lives of our client and experience we share with them, that will also help you to master as well as help and assist your client. Thank you.